Okay? We said that the mics picked that one up.
I will call a meeting to order, and because the first portion of the meeting constitutes effectively the annual general meeting of our community, I will, with deference to the acting mayor, I'll chair the first portion of it and then hand the chair over.
We have not received any other additional business items prior to the start of the meeting.
Agenda is as set out. Madam Clerk.
First item on the agenda is the minutes of the Counseling Committee meeting held on Monday, June 13, 2016. The recommendation is that the committee approve the minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Move by Councilor Zerillo, second by Councilor Hodge. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 2 is a presentation on the 2015 annual report. We have the General Manager and Financial Services and Manager of Corporate Planning to present.
Click yours. Click mine. Sure. I need to put it on the.
So, for anyone at home that's watching, the annual report is now published, and you can go online and get a copy of it or get one from here at City Hall.
Yes, it's lovely.
Ms. McLeod.
Good afternoon. So, Graham and I are here today to present our 2015 annual report. We're very pleased to be here. This presentation this afternoon, along with the SOFI report that's later on the agenda and the DCC report, wrap up all the statutory reporting that's required from 2015. So after today, 2015 is actually behind us, so that's kind of good. I hope you've all had a chance to look at this. It looks really particularly nice this year. Love the picture on the front. Our annual report is traditionally a finance department document. It contains our financial statements. And in recent years, you will have noticed that it's really not a finance department report at all anymore. It's a real team effort. And this is a perfect example of what you can get when you have the right people doing the right jobs. Because while the finance people do a fabulous job of creating our financial statements and all the graphs and all the things that we do, we're not the best at putting together wonderful documents like this. And so, but when you combine all the talents, it turns out much better. So it's Graham and the corporate planning group that put together all the work plan information that he's going to be talking to you about. And of course, it's our corporate communications team that puts together the whole package and is the glue that winds it all together. They sort of pick our theme, which this year is Communities in Bloom, and they help us with all the pictures and the format, and they actually keep us on track to get it all done at the right time. So this is a perfect example of a team effort, and we can't be happy enough. The finance people would be more than happy to give away the picture part of it and all the pretty part. But it's the best part and the part that people like the best. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Graham and let him talk to you about the work plan information.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So the first thing is I'd really like to echo Sheena's comments. This is really a beautiful document, and thank you to Kathleen and her team for leading the progress of it. It's really come together quite nicely, I think. So this afternoon I'm going to be talking a little bit about the accomplishments related to the 2015 business plan priorities and the strategic plan. As you know, the City of Coquitlam's strategic plan has 5 goals for the City of Coquitlam, and these lead us towards 2019. These 5 goals form the basis of our planning, performance measurements, and annual business plan priorities, as well as our financial plans. You'll notice that many of the initiatives presented today are in different phases of development. They may have shifted from one department to another, depending on the timeline that are involved. While this is an annual report, much of our planning is done in multi-year phases, as you know, from conception to planning to implementation to finalization. I would characterize 2015 as an investment in wow. You really only have to look outside the window to see kind of how far some of these projects have come. And if you visit any part of our community, you're sure to see the same thing. The projects and the work that I'm highlighting today are exactly that. They're highlights. It's not a comprehensive list. You'll have to check out the annual report to get the whole gamut of everything. But without further ado, our first goal is to strengthen neighborhoods. This is a goal seeking to have a community comprised of safe, green, and inclusive neighborhoods that are connected and foster a sense of belonging. To this end, we completed considerable work and consultation on the Coquitlam Lougheed Neighborhood Plan, continued to work with the province on the Evergreen Line, which is nearing completion in both Coquitlam and Town Center, designed and completed numerous road projects in the Northeast, including David and Coast Meridian, developed work on the affordable housing strategy, and council endorsed a broad framework to that end. Prepared for the Coquitlam 2016 BC 55 Plus Games, which aims to improve health, lifestyle, and image of British Columbia's 55 plus population. And we developed programs and plans for the Coquitlam 125th anniversary celebrations, including Town Center Park Plaza. Our next goal is about expanding jobs and prosperity and seeks to secure a vibrant and local economy. To this end, we fostered local employment by working with the Chamber of Commerce on the 2015 Economic Summit, Small Business Week, and the Tricelerate Innovation Hub. We facilitated vibrancy in sport, culture, recreation to enhance economic growth by introducing a five-year Coquitlam tourism strategy to focus on developing the tourism sector in Coquitlam. This reflects the Renata Bedroom Community of Vancouver. We are the fifth largest city in British Columbia and a destination for people to visit, and this is going to be made easier by this time next year once the Evergreen Line is completed. We held 215 business retention and expansion meetings with local business and completed 409 requests for assistance. We held 178 business attraction meetings with various businesses, government agencies, and consulates, and received over 70 business attraction inquiries. Received 109 permits with $85,000 in filming revenue distributed to various city departments, and we continue to expand QNET, Wi-Fi, and cellular networks throughout the city to enhance access and bandwidth. Our next goal focuses on increasing active participation and creativity to sustain a healthy community that includes physical, spiritual, and social wellness for our residents and the community. As part of this, we approved the draft Parks, Recreation, and Culture Master Plan. This plan outlines the community's values and aspirations for Coquitlam's parks, recreation, and culture, provides a baseline assessment for our service areas, and it works to create a balance of programs and services in the short, medium, and long term, and work continues to finalize the plan as we continue to consult with residents. We encourage citizens to be active through a range of recreational activities, including our partnership with Westminster Savings. This provided 31 free swim and skate sessions that were attended by over 7,000 people. And the Get Connected, Get Active program, which saw a total of 3,813 participants. Participation also increased by 87% in child and youth summer admissions, and this was up to 83,250. We developed a sustainable system of parks and open space by finalizing the Mundy Park Forest Management Plan, a strategy to ensure the 400 acres of unfragmented second growth forest, two lakes and creeks are able to foster a healthy forest ecosystem. And we continued work on the middle school walk bike accessibility program, drafting action plans for four of the eight middle schools for phased implementation this year in 2016. We made good progress on our goal of building capacity and capability to deliver high-quality services that are socially, economically, and environmentally sustainable. To this end, we finalized the Smiling Creek Elementary School Park Joint Use Agreement. We announced an agreement in principle with the YMCA for a facility in the Coquitlam neighborhood. We continue to manage the city's transportation system efficiently by promoting sustainable modes of transportation through the school walkability and sidewalk programs, and partnered with TransLink on the Travel Smart program. We also approved and constructed the City Center District Energy Project, which uses the same Thermonex technologies that's used up at Poirier. And we undertook an inventory and analysis of potential sponsorship opportunities for civic facilities, programs, and events with stakeholders and businesses in a way to enhance sustainability of our services and facilities in partnership with others. And our final goal is to achieve excellence in city governance through a strong governance model that is based on the principles of openness, fairness, and accountability, and that ensures informed decision-making throughout the organization. To this end, we participate in the Tri-Cities Transportation Task Force to provide a united voice for transportation improvements in the northeast sector of Metro Vancouver. Through the Stop Doing List and the work plan, the Business Improvement Committee addressed 51 items to enhance efficiency. We also implemented a number of initiatives to support and empower employees, including completing the first leadership development program. So that concludes the part of the presentation about our business plan priorities. I'll pass it back to Sheena for the financial highlights.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was wonderful.
Okay. I like that statement, investment and wow, because from a financial highlights point of view, I would say we had a big wow this year because if you're a finance person, this all sounds really good. Our assets went up, our debts went down, we had a surplus in each area, and of course we have an unqualified audit opinion, which what that means is that our auditors, KPMG, believe that these financial statements properly reflect what happened during the year and properly portray our financial results, which are all very good. So looking, starting with our balance sheet, we ended the year with a cash position of $347 million, and I know that that sounds like a bigger wow than it really is, but it does sound good. Our cash is divided into four basic parts. The first part at $91 million is money that we have on hand for very specific purposes. More often than not, that is money that people have given us for specific things, and we must hold that money to use it for what they gave it to us for. Things like development cost charges, things like prepayments on their taxes, we have to use that to pay their taxes. So it's money we don't have a lot of access to. We can't use it for anything we'd like. We also have money for operating reserves, and what that is we have a number of expenditures that we have during the year that we budget for at a sort of an average level. But what happens is the way we use those kind of things may vary over time. And so things like weather-related things or tax appeals, sometimes you get a lot of them, sometimes you get a little of them. So we have a number of types of expenditures where if we don't use all the money, we set it aside in a reserve for another year when we will use more than what we would have in the budget. So we have a number of those kind of things, and that we have about $27 million set aside for. The largest area of the money that we have, or the cash we have on hand, is related to taking care of our infrastructure, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute because that's one of our biggest challenges. We have this huge infrastructure to take care of, and so we set aside money on a regular basis to be able to maintain and replace that infrastructure. So it looks like a lot of money, but relative to the value of our infrastructure, not that much. And finally, we have some surplus, which is sort of our retained earnings that you would have in a business set aside for emergencies in the future. Okay. Looking at the biggest part of our balance sheet is, of course, our capital assets. And that right now, the historic value of our capital is over $2 billion. The net book value, so the depreciated value, is $1.8 million. That represents the depreciated historic value of all the roads and the pipes and the buildings that our citizens rely on every single day to do what they do in the community. They rely on the roads to get to work. They rely on the pools to take their kids to swim lessons. They expect it to be there. And so the value of that is about $1.8 billion. The replacement value of that is considerably more. Okay? This year we added to that asset balance by $53 million of things that the city built, and another $24 million that developers build on our behalf, but then when they're completed they turn it over to us and we have to take care of that. So that is one of the biggest issues that we need to deal with in managing the finances of the city. Okay, looking at our liability is the next part of the balance sheet. This is how much money we owe. So at the end of the year, we owed $22 million, divided amongst the funds this way. And I know that $22 million seems like an awful lot of money. But when you compare that to over $2 billion worth of debt, it's not really that much at all. It's less than 1%, which would be like if you had a $1 million home having a $10,000 mortgage. So we're in pretty good financial shape. Like every balance sheet, it comes down to your net worth. Or in a business, it would be your retained earnings. With us, it's our accumulated surplus. And that represents the balance of what we own out of this operation. And that comes to about $2 billion on our financial statement. I'd love to say that that was all cash we had in the bank. Unfortunately, it's not. Most of that is equity in our assets. It means that all that $2 billion worth of assets, we mostly own it. There's $1.8 billion of equity. And the rest is the cash we've got set aside primarily to take care of that infrastructure, because that's really the bulk of our business. Okay, looking at the city's statement of operations, first looking at our revenues came in at $284 million. It's a pretty big number. You can see that 78% of that, the blue pieces of pie there, represent monies that come in from our residents, either in the form of taxes for services that are provided to everybody, like parks and roads and protection, or about 28% is for services and fees, where there are specific services that people get, maybe a building permit or they get admission to a pool, so they get it specifically. The remaining 25% comes from a number of sort of outside sources, developer contributions, grants, casino money. And this is very consistent year over year. It almost always looks just about like this. On the spending side, our expenditures were $218 million. And again, it's in a very consistent spending distribution of prior years. All of the gray ones together are public works. That's taking care of all the roads and the pipes and delivering the public works service. The next biggest area is protection. That's about 25%. That's police and fire. Those are the blue pieces of pie. And the green one is parks and rec, about 25%. So if you look at all that, and the final little piece, which is about 15%, includes planning, and then all of the overhead type services or the support services like human resources and finance and council, all those kinds of things. Okay? Again, this is very similar to other years.
Chris, did you want to ask?
The darker blue, it says other protection, 1%. That's
police.
And what's that's the correct police. Number?
Sorry, we've got two other protections. You've got a little boo-boo there. Yeah, it's police. One's police, one's fire. The two blues.
And the larger, the blue one is 12. About 15%. Is that 15% or what is the number?
Yeah, that should be about 15%.
Okay.
Because it's 25% all overall.
Yes.
Good, thank you.
Yeah, he's got it.
My camera's got to be 12. It's 12, 12, and 1.
And finally, our annual surplus, if you take that $284 million and you look at our revenue and you look at our spending, which is 218, anybody who's good at math will tell you, you come out at between $65 and $66 million. And so it sounds like, wow, we had all that extra money. But that doesn't include our capital expenditures. Remember, I just told you that we had capital expenditures of $54 million from the city and $23 million from developers. So there's all sorts of other money that we draw in from previous periods that help us to balance that equation. At the end of the day, looking at our budget, we were able to put $3 million into our infrastructure reserve, bringing our balance up to $4.7 million. And that's going to help us immensely going forward into this challenging year that we're, you know, getting ready for lots of wow, because we've got some pretty big expenditures. We all know that the marketplace is going great guns out there, and it's causing us some challenges in inflation, and this is going to assist us in being able to address those kind of things. So at the end of the day, what does all this mean? It means that 2015 was a very good year for the city. We made all sorts of progress on our work plan goals. We made headway on everything that is we're trying to achieve in the community, and we also ended up a little bit better off financially. So that will put us in good stead going into 2017.
Thank you.
Any questions?
The certificates that we give on the leadership program, we don't give the certificate that's attached to anything like another Douglas College or anybody else, do we?
No. If we do, no.
Is there any way that we could turn our leadership certificates into something more meaningful in, you know, municipal education?
We'll certainly look at that. That's a good point. A lot of people recognize training they get in various organizations, and we'll look at alternate ways of doing it.
Yeah, and I don't know, would Douglas College or would it be SFU or somebody that could even develop a program that we could sort of do?
It may be difficult to link our stuff with an ongoing educational institute in the short term because they will then want to dictate exactly how we do it, and we really target that to practical experience and practical needs of our organization. But we will look at that in all different ways.
It would be worthwhile for our employees.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Councilor Zerillo.
I just wanted to thank Graham for the presentation. It's one of the few times we've seen you up here, but I did feel the need to ask or mention about the Expand Local Jobs Prosperity, the point about partnering with the City Chambers of Commerce. You mentioned something about the Economic Summit.
The 2015 Economic Summit.
Yeah, I just wanted to understand how that's falling in. Like, I guess what I'm wondering is, I know who put together the Economic Summit, I know who put the hours into the Economic Summit, and I'm just wondering what our contribution was to the Economic Summit outside of the money.
I was just going to say we were one of the sponsors of the event, but David's not here in terms of exactly what.
Well, I just wanted to call it out because the Economic Summit was a lot more than just the checks that came, and I would rather that the chamber, it's just on the record that it wasn't the city of Coquitlam that ran the economic summit or championed the economic summit.
Yeah, that's a point well taken.
Thank you.
Dennis?
Thank you very much. Great presentation. Thank you. I wrote down as well an investment in WOW, and I think that truly sums up what we're seeing outside the doors of City Halls and across the community. There's a lot going on, and I think staff quite often goes, "Wow, council wants us to do something else." That being the case, council, or at least this councilor, does want us to do something else. I'm happy to see the overall financial strength of the city. They're certainly going in the right direction. I think we can still talk about greater clarification in terms of presentation of documents. There's certain legal stuff we have to do. I think the notes speak to your comments about the surplus. The surplus does look greater from a cash perspective than it really is, because so much of it is real estate and pipes and pavement. So it's not a dollar necessarily. When you see $65 million up there, it's not $65 million. The dollars are actually ballpark cash flow-wise marginal after you subtract the capital piece that we put in, correct?
You mean the cash surplus at the end of the day?
So
$3 million that we put in the infrastructure reserve.
Exactly. Okay. The one piece I noticed on page 30 in the letter of transmittal, the accountants specifically put out the overall rate of return on our investments at 1.54. That is up from previous years. But I do note, I still think that's an area where we can certainly see a greater return on. Each 0.1%, given our asset base, is $350,000 to the bottom line. So I really want to see in the coming year if we can identify the areas of expanding that investment portfolio or investment policy, or utilizing the tools that are already there to ensure that we're maximizing return. I know Metro Van, we've talked about this before, has done some stuff recently. I think 1.54, given this size of portfolio, is still light. And I think there's some meat left on that bone for us. I think the banks and credit unions would be happy to give us more. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Are there any members of the audience who have comments related to our annual report? Any of the members of the public who are here who wanted to comment on the annual report?
Tweet them.
Anybody
down.
Want to comment?
Open the door. There's a few in the other room.
Well, it's
open,
an open
the door and say it louder. Yes, that's a good point.
Door. It's an open door and an open mic.
Absolutely.
And the sign on the outside as well says what the meeting is. Seeing none, a motion, please.
So moved. So second.
The motion is to approve the annual report. Question? All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Good presentation.
Excellent. We'll now hand the meeting over to our acting mayor, Councilor Zerillo.
Thank you. Item 3 is the 2015 Statement of Financial Information. The recommendation is that the committee receive the report for information.
All right. I guess, does anyone have a comment on the SOF? Councilor O'Neill.
Yeah, the Statement of Financial Information. It got some news coverage over the weekend, specifically related to high salaries for senior staff and high expenses for some counselors, all of which can and should be explained. And there's other things in there as well the public might look at and say, gee, there's 88 regular firefighters, or 78, making $100,000 a year or more. Not even deputy chiefs or anything like that. There are certain financial realities that cities have to deal with. And perhaps you can deal with the first one. I'd like to be, and it's hard for senior staff to talk about senior staff salaries, but the public does look at that and say, holy mackerel, they got half a dozen people making $200,000 or more. How is that possible? This is way too much. Can somebody, perhaps not fair for the general manager of financial services, might be for the city manager to talk about it, I don't know, to explain how the salary structure sort of works and what the market conditions are, and or should I attempt to do that? I don't really want to do that. It's your report, staff's report. The figures are there. The public always has their eyebrows being their eyebrows are always raised, and the media do look at this and say, wow, it's a lot. So
so what's your question specifically?
Well, the question is there a way to for us to explain to the public why these salaries are where they're at?
Point of order. These are statements of amount that have been paid in a calendar year.
Yeah.
In most cases, they don't reflect the salary. They reflect how much they got paid that calendar year, if they took payout for vacation, if they're retroactive pay. None of that is related to their salary. It is only the amount they get paid. So we have to be really careful with the wording we use. These aren't salary statements.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Total compensation.
Perhaps John can take a stab at that.
I'm perfectly okay for anybody to tackle this. I want just to be out there to have this being aired. And so we're not sweeping it under a carpet and ignoring it, because it is a cause of...
Mr. Dewey.
Okay. As a general overview comment, we're in a competitive market for talent in Greater Vancouver, so we compete against other Lower Mainland municipalities for the people that we attract to our organization, and we, of course, try to attract the best people possible. In terms of how we set our salaries, we benchmark our salaries. And to do that, we use four municipalities that are our closest comparators to set our salaries. And those four are the two that are immediately bigger and two that are immediately smaller, the bigger ones being Richmond and Abbotsford, and the two that are the next biggest in size under us, Langley Township and Delta. And we set our salaries at the 50th percentile of the average of those four municipalities. So we try not to be higher than others or lower than others, but position ourselves in a competitive way in the market. That doesn't give us an advantage in terms of salaries other people are paying, but we think Coquitlam's a great community, and there's lots happening here, and we're an employer of choice, and we try to use those aspects to differentiate ourselves from others, because basically we're paying similar to what the market is being paid in Greater Vancouver.
And the consequences of, let's say, cutting everything by 20% to try to save money would be less attractive employer. People would, even though there's a lot of things that are good about to work in Coquitlam, a wonderful place to work, young up-and-coming professionals or engineers or whatever, if they want to make good money, and if we weren't offering competitive salaries, we would not have as qualified a staff as we have. So that's essentially what you said.
Yes, I would say we're in a robust labor market in our business right now. You can see the growth around Greater Vancouver, and our community is a shining example of that. So there's lots of demand for people in our business, and if we were to pay significantly less than others, we would lose a lot of our good people, and it would be very difficult to attract people here, because essentially people that live in Coquitlam or Burnaby or whatever can drive, you know, from without relocating to a number of different municipalities. So you have to be competitive within this market.
Thank you. Moving on to 88 firefighters making $100,000 a year. Or more, at least a salary, whatever.
It's
88 in there. Mm-hmm. Counted them. And this has been in $100,000 a year firefighter has been in the news for a few years all across Canada. And so, are you able to tell me what why it is that when and salaries have been going up quite a bit every year, a couple percentage points every year. How it is that we pay our, I know council has agreed to contracts. What's the system that drives these high salaries? Can you tell me that?
I can take that one as well,
Mr. Dumont.
Because fire service is a protective services, it's deemed an essential service. So while fire departments sometimes collective bargain their settlements, they also have the choice to go to arbitration. And arbitrators set the fire salaries based on comparisons of other municipalities in BC as well as across Canada. So that's typically how settlements happen. In this particular year, and the pattern around the region has been, there was a 2.5% a year settlement. Some municipalities have settled for 8 years and some for only 4 years, but that was 2012 through 2015 for the four-year settlements, which is what Coquitlam settled for. That was the regional pattern. And so there was retroactive pay in this particular year for the 2012 to 2015 settlement. Having said that, you know, the base salary range is creeping up to $100,000 per year. And if there hadn't been retroactive pay this particular year, we would still see large numbers of firefighters that are getting up and over the $100,000 range. But those fire salaries are largely driven through a essential service sort of system where they can go to arbitrators and arbitrators deem what a fair settlement is.
Okay. And our firefighters do a fantastic job, and our citizens think the firefighters and fire rescue service does a fantastic job as well. But I know that people look at these figures and go, wow, that's a lot of money. So I wonder. The third thing I raised was the publicity over the weekend about council, individual council members' expenses, and I just want to make a statement on that one. I find it bizarre that the media would concentrate on the expenses of those councillors who were doing the most work outside of the council chambers, going to all of these conventions. And here I decided I didn't want to go to these conventions. And what conventions I did go to that were out of town, one like in Whistler, I think I've done it twice, I stayed at my own cabin or something like that. So I didn't claim these expenses. But, you know, I would think that if a news media outlet wanted to take an impactful look and really look at the value that taxpayers get for the money, It wouldn't be just on the expenses that were claimed. It would be on the value that comes back from that. And I'm certainly glad that several of my colleagues have gone to all the conventions across Canada in the last couple of years, because they do bring things back. And really, the guys who don't go to the conventions could just as easily be criticized. But that never happens. Why don't I get criticized for not going to Winnipeg or Edmonton? Why not? You know, I could be. Nobody does. Nobody ever does. I'm saying this publicly right now. And it just doesn't, it's always, oh, who's spending the most money? Who's claiming the most money? Well, it can be part of the job. It's not technically part of the job, but it's a weird state of affairs. And it's just coming at it from a narrow point of view. And I want to defend my fellow councillors with these high expenses. Well, not really that high. But my goodness, they went to these conventions. They learned a lot. They brought stuff back to council, new perspectives. I think that's really great. So there you go. Thank you for allowing me to make a declaration.
Thank you, Councillor Reid.
Couldn't stop you.
Thank you. Well, I didn't know Councillor O'Neill was going to bring all this up, but he's raised some points that I think are really important. Mr. Dumont basically said some of the things I was going to say about how we've gone about hiring, and it wasn't always that way through most of the years, but in the last 15 years or so, we have hired an outside consultant and gone through the process. And it is a competitive market out there. And what I think the citizens have to realize is that the greatest asset we have in this city is our staff. This is the asset. And I can go out and put a job out there for 200 or 300,000, and I might get 6 or 8 or 20 applicants. It's the applicant that I pick and the applicant that I think will fit best and really join in my organization, join in with our staff, join in with our council, and work as this is a family and that it's his own. That's why we pay the salaries. We want the best people for the best job and those that can fit. We try, as a council, I think through all the years, to treat our staff well when we get our staff. We, in the later years now, have started offering training programs, which probably many of you in our city don't realize, but we offer training programs so that our staff can get used to their jobs can perform better, become part of our family. And when we are a family, we work together and we get more done. We don't expect people that we hire to come in at 9 and leave at 5 and take their appropriate coffee breaks and all that. I don't think that we have any employees that do that in the city of Coquitlam. We have employees that join in and become part of the Coquitlam family. I think when we offer the training programs, it also gives our staff opportunities to move up into other positions. That benefits us because we don't have to go out now and hire some other person with a very expensive salary who knows nothing about our city. We have staff that are here, that belong to the family, and that can move up and do, therefore, a better job. And as someone who's been here a long time, I'll tell you, it just makes me shudder when I see some of the salaries, as it does to all of you out there. But I think we've got the cream of the crop here, and I really don't want to lose any of them. And the other thing that Councillor O'Neill talked about was conventions. We have the federal, we have the UBCM, and we have the local LMGA. When you are a new councillor, you will never know what's available to you to do your job unless you at least go to one or two of these. And the new councillors that we have taken it for themselves to go to the federal ones. That's where we find out if Quebec is getting more things than we get, or Nova Scotia is doing something different that we could do. And that's how you gather information and how you bring it back and hopefully help us move on. I don't go to all the conventions because I will go to one if there is some particular thing there that I feel I really want to do and that's pertinent to this time of that convention. If it isn't, I won't go. I will most always go to the UBCM because that is our provincial one, and that is where we have lots in common. The LMLGA is where the Lower Mainland gets together. And you hear in the newspapers a lot about Uber and a lot about this particular one was very good. There was lots of people there talking about Uber, the taxi service, and how people are reacting towards it in different communities. Most importantly, I think, was the firefighters and the ambulance dealing with the courses that they are going to do. And last but not least, affordable housing and homeless. And all of those things we share because we're neighbors and we have the population moving in between our cities. So for those of you who think we get nothing out of this, please don't think that. For those of you who think that we lie in bed till 10 a.m. and get up and stretch and go out for a walk, don't think that either, because breakfast starts at like the ungodly hour of 7 a.m. or something. So we are up, we are out, and we are working. And believe you, I think that you have a council and staff that really work.
Thank you. Mayor Stewart.
Thank you. I say something like this every year because we typically get some kind of a comment, quite often from individuals in our community, but quite often through the media, about the strange process that identifies this list. This list is the number of people who were remunerated by more than $75,000.
Yes.
I'll begin with, what does that include? What payments, or is it like, are there benefits, or are there some other elements that go into the calculation of what gets to 75?
Yep. Your remuneration is anything that you are paid in the year. It's not necessarily your base salary. So if a particular person had some taxable benefits, they had their medical paid for, that kind of thing, that's a normal sort of benefit that comes with employment, that would be included in your remuneration. Okay. It could also be if somebody took a holiday payout, they might be bumped up. If somebody got paid some retroactive pay because they hadn't got a raise for 4 years and they got it all at once as a result of a settlement like all our firefighters, that would look like you had more remuneration in that year than would be your normal base salary. So there's all sorts of things, depending on everybody's individual situation, that could adjust that number in any given year. So it's not necessarily reflective of your base salary.
Thank you. And we say that every year because it's important that we say it because people will then say, you know, we see on all these comments that suggest, well, I can't believe you get $75,000 for that, plus all the overtime, plus all the benefits. No, it's $75,000 including all the
all
overtime,
that. Yeah.
Including any benefits, including all kinds of the elements. So it may well be a $60,000 salary plus some overtime because of the hot summer or whatever, or yes. the snowfall that we had. Looking at the firefighters' salaries, using that as an example, a couple of years ago, the headline was that we've doubled the number of people that make over $100,000. In 1 year, we doubled them, which meant to the public, we hired twice as many people in the 100,000. What really happened was the firefighters got a retroactive increase, which took them from 95 to 101, and the next year, they were back at 98. So the subsequent year, we once again doubled the number of people over 100,000. It was the same group of people, mind you, but just how this report calculates things. And it frustrates me that it's like this. It's so easy to misconstrue these salaries. And then I look down, and so if you acknowledge that in some cases, in every case here, this isn't their salary, this is their salary plus a percentage, a significant percentage, maybe 20% or something, that includes a number of other...
No, no, not 20%.
10%?
All of your benefits. It's only taxable benefits that are included here. It's not all of your benefits, and it's not the things that we also contribute to.
Which makes it all the more confusing. Right. So
it's
you look
confusing.
At subdivision and development technician, it was now crossed the 75 line. Trades to mechanics, there's several of them that have crossed the 75 line. The engineering inspectors, subdivision and development technician, we said that. Utility equipment operator. The construction market is so hot right now that equipment operators can do better than that in the private sector. And so that's one of the challenges of a union environment. We know that there are now union positions that are being reported using a number, the 75 and the 100 thresholds, that were developed years and years ago when that was only management. And now it incorporates a number of folks from what some people might consider just employment, non-salaried positions.
Interestingly enough, they have not updated that 75,000 in as long as I've been working for the city. So it's capturing, you know, with normal inflation, it's capturing a much larger group of people because they haven't escalated that as salaries have gone up. Originally, when they created this legislation, it was to capture only those that would have been considered quite a high salary at that time. Well, inflation comes along and, you know, some pretty average salaries end up being shown here. The other thing you might want to notice is beside a number of them have two little stars beside them, the names. That's to denote that those are places where there was a retroactive pay settlement, and you can see on the final page of that list, on page 46, gives a little key that says that it was 4 years of retroactive pay beside all of those people, which elevates the amount of money they got paid in any particular given year.
There you go. Oh, so the retroactive pay was in the order of...
It would have been about 10% over 4 years because it was 2.5% a year for 4 years. So our firefighters didn't get a raise for 4 years.
And then you
got a big one. Yeah.
So what's going to happen again? A bunch of these $105,000 firefighters are going to be back at 97 next year.
Yes.
And we will once again elevate them. We're going to be doing this over and over again.
But they haven't settled for the out years yet, so you might get a lag before that happens again.
Yeah. Yeah,
but you're understanding how this works.
Yeah, we'll have exactly the same accusation or discussion.
More.
I say it every year, and I'll say it again, that there is nothing more expensive to a municipality than a cheap engineer, than a cheap mechanic. Some of these good technicians are worth their weight, and if we went down a little bit in what we paid them, we would end up with much, much lower. We wouldn't have as many people to choose from. We try all the time to post for, we talk, the conversations we have here is maybe we could try to reach out to the private sector and see if we can attract an engineer from the private sector or a land manager from the private sector. We don't pay enough because they simply don't apply because the private sector pays more for those positions. The skilled ones that we would want to attract from those positions, we have to work really hard to retain the ones we have. And now, as far as council attendance at conferences, I say it all the time, I encourage council members, if they can, to go
and participate fully in the conferences that benefit this community. Every time I go to a conference, I know I come back with enough stuff to make it more than worth my time to go. Let's face it, I just came back from Winnipeg. It's an exotic location in Canada. But it was a really good conference. It was valuable. I brought back several elements that I'm be presenting to engineering or to other groups as by way of starting a discussion about the other ways that other communities do it. We hear from folks in, particularly elected officials in other communities, that sometimes when the story hits the newspapers about the ones that went to the conference, no one wants to go anymore because, perhaps in some councils, there are some council members who really don't go to conferences. They just never, and perhaps even they don't reach out and try to do more within their position. And they're the ones that everyone lauds as being absolutely the most fiscally conscious because they never actually try to reach out and try to engage more with other communities or with other, with the trade show at the FCM and UBCM, for example, which I find invaluable. The trade shows generally related to our work are incredibly important because we can go out there and find the kinds of elements that some communities use to improve the service to their community. So I support those who have taken the initiative to go to conferences. I know that some have been to many, many conferences over many years and are more judicious when they are choosing those, but particularly for the new members of council, the ones that were elected 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I want them to continue to attend those conferences because we need them to be absolutely informed and absolutely knowledgeable about the work that we do because we're a growing city and an incredible, their position here, the decision making in their position needs to benefit from the stuff that they're going to learn from conferences, the stuff they're going to learn from other delegates at conferences and other elected officials, the stuff they're going to bring back, the awards and or the grant programs that we're going to be able to apply for because we learn about them or talk to a federal official about our particular project when we go to those conferences. Thank you very much to those members that do it. I recognize you're going to get criticized because your expenses are higher. That's it.
All right. I had myself on and then Councillor Towner. So I'm going to take a bit of more of a holistic approach to the SOFIs. Congratulations. These are incredible numbers. And I know it was a lot of hard work. It doesn't just happen. So I want to put that out there at first. We're going to have some hard decisions to make at budget time this year, I think, because we probably have a little bit more money than we even need to be saving for, although I know I hear you on the infrastructure and saving for the future infrastructure. I totally hear you on that. But I'm going to be struggling with whether it's time to reward a little bit more the community and stuff like that. So I just wanted to say job well done, and I'll be interested at the budget time having the discussion about should we continue to be saving in some of these pots because, unfortunately, we can't always take from pot A to fund something that's in pot B. I have a few questions. I gave you a heads up about them, but the first one relates to the consolidated statement of operations on revenue side. We saw the graph in the annual report, and I decided not to ask questions around the annual because all my notes were in the SOFI. It's about the fees, rates, and service charges where we budgeted, and we had quite a large over budget in that area. I'm assuming it's DCCs, but I'm going to give you the chance
It's a couple of things.
Okay.
It's a number of things. It's a little bit of Parks and Rec revenue. They were over in their revenues, which shows up in there.
Okay.
It's also DCCs, it's bonus density, and CAC. So it's mostly the big numbers come from that development revenue. But a little bit of it is extra admissions and those kinds of things.
Okay. So I noticed we have notes, like taxation we have no, grants in lieu we have a note. Can we get a note? Or are these prescribed notes that you wouldn't...
We could put it. We don't generally put notes about variances.
Okay.
We put notes about what's the makeup of
what's
included in there.
That's what I mean. Is it possible to get a note about just what's included in there?
Yeah.
Just because I was interested. So you say there was some overage in Parks and Rec.
There was some extra revenue.
Was it material? Like, was it large, or was the, like, I mean, we're looking at,
well, it was larger million? Than, because I know that your next question will be about the expenses in parks and recreation, and so this is the difference. That's a really good question. I'm kind of glad you asked it, because people look at this and it stands out that it looks like, when you compare our base budget, that and that parks and rec is overspent. But they're not overspent, because they did have extra expenditures, but they had extra offsetting revenue. And you can imagine the kind of business that Parks and Recreation is in. We respond to the community, and lots of the programs and things that we put on are based on how many people come, and lots of them pay for themselves with admissions. So our internal reporting, Parks and Rec had a surplus of $300,000. It's just that the way the external statements look, that's prescribed not by us, but prescribed externally, we show our expenditures by department, but we don't show our revenues by department. We show our revenues by the type of money it was. That's why embedded in that $80 million of fees, there's additional revenue to the tune of almost $1 million in Parks and Rec. But it's offset by expenses.
Okay. And we did budget for it, though. We didn't anticipate it.
Yeah, and you know, it often happens that way in Parks and Rec, because so much of what they do is demand-based, but as long as it's paying for itself as it goes, we carry on. We give the service that people need.
So this is a $13 million difference. I didn't do the percentage, but this is about $13 million.
Yeah, most of the biggest part of that is not Parks and Rec, of course. That's a very small part of it. The biggest part is that development revenue, and most of that development revenue, particularly the bonus density and the CACs and some of the DCCs, we don't actually budget those, because they're so variable and so lumpy that if we guess the wrong way, then we'd be short $10 million. And so they come in big, big lumps.
So that's interesting, because on the later, for my later question, I can see that we haven't budgeted for it. So what do we usually do with that DCC? Because I think earlier in the presentation before that, we said that they're very consistent year over year. But they're quite large, so I'm just looking for the, oh, here it is.
The percentage of all of our revenues are very consistent.
Okay.
But, and
so the 25% or the 28% yes. Number is very consistent.
Yeah, okay. the 75% yeah.
So
is very
I see
consistent.
It on page 27, Schedule B, under developer contributions. Yes, we don't budget for it, and it came in at $12.5 million.
Yeah.
So is it the year before it was $15 million? So I guess my question is, should we be budgeting for it?
There's different aspects for different parts of that revenue stream. We do budget for the DCC revenues because they're based on long-term plans and strategies. Up until now, we have not budgeted for bonus density because it is just a recent program that's happened. It goes all into a dedicated reserve, and council spends out of that reserve as council sees fit. And so what we have said to the development community is our moral obligation to you, it's moral, not legal, is that we will try to spend it on projects that provide services to the extra projects that created revenue. So, for example, we will provide extra parks amenity in a park near one of the towers or something like that. We funded the Lincoln Station out of that source of money. But it's not a consistent stream, and it's not the kind of thing that we budget on an annual basis, but council does have the ability, and actually we do not make any decisions without council approving them, but it's more on a one-off project basis. That is the bonus density. The CAC is just a new program that up until now has just been in the Coquitlam Lougheed area, and all of that is being collected is going towards funding the YMCA, so that YMCA is not any burden on the existing taxpayers. For example, we started a new community center, there would be a significant burden on existing taxpayers. That whole YMCA project is being funded totally through that service, and it's not costing the taxpayer anything. But it's that source of money that's going to pay that project. So that's why it's done in that way.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. I'm just thinking maybe we could be, we know it's going to come to some degree, not necessarily the CAC or the bonus density, but the DCC, we know it's going to come.
We do budget for that.
We budget for it. There's a real complication in there it's an accounting anomaly that you don't actually recognize DCCs as they're collected. You recognize them as they're spent. And so if we spend more on a project because we move faster, we will look like we have a variance because we didn't plan
for
that.
So tell me, because I'm trying to visualize it in my brain on the balance sheet, so where do we recognize it? Because we have to recognize it at some...
We recognize it in the income statement.
Yeah.
So what will happen is we collect a DCC.
Yeah.
Our cash balance will go up.
Yeah, but we've already spent it.
And our equity will go up because that reserve for capital expenditures will go up.
Yeah.
And then if we spend it the next year, we'll recognize it as a revenue and an expenditure the following year.
Okay.
So there's a timing. A number of these revenues, they kind of move through in a process. They get kind of collected 1 year and spent 1 year. And it's an anomaly that's related to the fact that with DCCs, we are absolutely committed to use that money for the specific projects in the DCC program.
Yeah.
We don't actually recognize the revenue until we're spending it attached to the project because it comes with a big liability. We're liable to the developers that paid that money to hold it for that project. It's really quite complicated.
So where does it sit?
But the bonus
so where
density
does it sit before you spend it again?
In the reserve, or sorry, in deferred revenue. It's in the line on your balance sheet that's called deferred revenue. And if you see, it's on your balance sheet on page 1, it's $57 million. And then on note 3, it'll tell you how much of that is the DCCs. That's where it sits while it's waiting.
Yep.
And then we budget it in capital projects, but if we spend a little more or a little less, we'll recognize a little more or a little less, and those kind of things are weather dependent, all sorts of things.
So we have we've budgeted it in capital investments, so that's why we don't put it in the budget here.
But bonus density and CACs, while they seem to all of us like they're the same as DCCs, from an accounting perspective, and I know this is really complicated and only, you know, detailed accountants can appreciate this, they're not treated that way. We recognize them when we receive them, because they don't have the same connected liability to them. We have much more flexibility on what we do with them. So we recognize those when we receive them.
That's okay, so in this fees, rates, and service charges, we can have very recent CACs and bonus density.
Yes.
But we most likely will not be seeing the DCC because it's sitting in some reserve fund somewhere until we spend it.
You will be seeing some amount of DCCs every year because we spend some.
My question is, shouldn't we be budgeting?
And we do budget that. We do. Otherwise, the comparative number, that $67 million, which is the budget, would be much less if there are no DCCs in there.
Okay, but then when I go to the general fund statement of operations on page 27, under developer contribution, it's zero budgeted. It's a dash.
Sorry, where are you?
Page 27, general fund, city of Coquitlam statement of operations. There's... I guess that's the fund that doesn't have anything budgeted.
Oh, that's a different thing. Now, that is... Remember I told you that when we added to our assets, our asset base went up by $54 million that we built, which we may use CACs for.
Yeah.
It also went up by $24 million that was built by developers. The developer contribution is the value of the assets that developers built on our behalf. Gosh. Otherwise, we'd have a misstatement because we have ownership of them and no matching. Sure. So that's a different thing. The DCCs are used to build infrastructure that we build. We collect money from them and we build it. There's also a whole bunch of infrastructure that developers build that we don't pay for. So we build the trunk mains and the arterial roads. They build the local roads and, you know, the littler pipes that go to houses. And they turn that all over to us. So every year there's a process of how much of those assets they built. They have drawings, they give them to us, and we recognize the value of those assets. And so that number that you're looking at, which is $24 million on page 2, page 2 is the consolidated, so that means the reason it's bigger than on page 27, page 27 you're looking at probably roads and things.
Okay.
This is roads and pipes because it's got sewer and water added in.
Okay.
That's the value of all the things that developers built for us in the year that we got the drawings for, they got completed, and we know what they're worth.
Okay.
And we have to recognize that, but it's different than what we build using the DCC money.
And I've heard you say that many, many times before. I just was surprised to see such a big discrepancy between budget and actuals for that.
We have no idea what they're building out there. And it's almost better not to budget it so you know. We don't budget it. That's what came in the year. We could make up a number, but we could be grossly off. And
so then my next question is about the cost recoveries. We have quite a variance in the cost recoveries for two from $5 to $10 million. Is there any background on that?
I have notes on all those, but it's in a different statement. It's in my annual report, not in Sophie. So let me just get there.
Okay.
So which one are you looking at?
Cost recoveries.
What page are you on?
Oh, okay. Page two on
Sophie.
Yeah.
Sophie or?
Yeah. On the Sophie, it's on page two. And if you're looking at your annual report, which is what I'm looking at, it's page 33. But it's exactly the same financial statement.
Okay.
And the difference with that was some of it, we got sort of an unusual amount of the 5% in lieu fund. So that, you know how when there's subdivisions happening and they have to give us 5% in lieu? There's $3.5 million of it is that. Okay? And some of it was...
For accountant, I guess?
Yep. Yeah. And the POCO recovery was a little bit higher than we anticipated. And some recoveries from ICBC on road works. Because we're always trying to go out and depending on what road work we're doing.
Okay. And was there detail on that? And I just missed it. Sorry about that.
Nope, there's not a note on that
okay.
one.
All right. So then I also I did have a question about parks, rec, and culture. So we budgeted 48 and we ended up at 49.5. And my question, I know I was asking a couple of weeks ago about having the last few projects, if we could understand if they were over or under budget. But I just want to understand if this overage is about cost park overruns or if this is additional work that we took on outside of what we budgeted at the beginning of the year.
This is from operations, so this doesn't include any capital projects. So this is the ongoing operation, people coming into the pools, and what happens is they're bringing more revenue, they got to get more cleaning.
Well, because we have more revenue, it totally makes sense to me that we would be over on the operations.
And then what happens is you get some net zeros next year, because we know we're bigger, we're doing more, but the revenue offsets the cost. And so then Raul will be coming and saying he's got some net zeros because he needs to provide this service to a growing community.
Yeah.
He's got the revenue, but he needs you to prove that it's okay to do this.
Yeah. No, that one totally makes sense. Okay, page 18, pension plan. This kind of came up at the school district, but we have a $1.37 million funding deficit. I realize that this is not just Coquitlam. It's a larger, probably, area. But I just wanted to understand... What plan we have in place or how we managed for that deficit. Page 18, the most recent valuation as of December 31st indicated $1.37 million funding deficit for basic pension benefits.
And that is managed through the Pension Corporation. And what the Pension Corporation will do is every 2 years they do an actuarial evaluation to go where are we sitting, and then they will adjust everybody's pension payments, employees and employers. And it
doesn't
belong to us.
I didn't think
it's
so.
The it's the whole plan, which is municipal, school, college, you know, the whole government pension plan.
Okay, so we're at the mercy on that one.
Yeah, but it's another one of those things where it sounds like an enormous amount
of
money, and we're by law we have to put in this note that tells you that there is sort of an unfunded liability out there, but it's quite minuscule compared to the size of the plan, and so it's not going to have a material effect on us.
Okay, so that comes into my next point, which is about materiality, which was on page 20, talking about commitments and contingencies, and there's a note here that there's. We have undeterminable amounts for potential litigations happening, but that they are not material. And I'm just wondering, do we define or does KPMG define what that materiality threshold is and what is it for the city?
Okay, KPMG has, they decide what the materiality threshold is because it's what they're prepared to live with to sign off our statements, because obviously at any given time there's variances. The city at any given time has a number of lawsuits pending. You guys get a report that tells you all about that, and every one of those could have a potential value. Of course, until you settle it, you don't know what that value is. The reason that when they evaluate this and they say it's not material is because we have properly provided an insurance reserve to cover us for any of those liabilities because now we self-insure, right? And so that's why it's immaterial. It doesn't mean that any of those particular lawsuits would be or wouldn't be material. It means that we have properly covered that liability to a reasonable expectation, and so it couldn't possibly have a material effect on our statements.
Okay, so that's different than materiality threshold. Basically, what we're saying is regardless of what the number is, it's going to not be materialized because we have it insured.
Right.
Okay, so then in the other one on page 20 that I found interesting was
number H that talks about the YMCA of Greater Vancouver. And, you know, I did have a question about this, about unionized employees. I mean, we haven't had this discussion about who's going to be running this YMCA, but I'm wondering if that needs to be. Is that any discussion for the financial?
We have had a discussion about who's going to be running it. The YMCA is going to be running it. Yeah. We are not going to be running it.
We're not going to be running it. Part of the agreement.
Okay. And I think that might be it, but I really appreciate it because it was a really, really good read. Like I said, I just think, I'm the best to you for having such a strong SOFI report this year. Yeah, that was it.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
I'm here for one more.
My turn.
Councillor Towner.
Thank you. I just want to take a minute to touch on the fact that, yes, there are some big numbers here, and some members of the public may perceive that we overpay some of our staff, and therefore we aren't spending their tax dollars as prudently as we can. And Mr. Dumont commented on how we have to be competitive in this market to attract the quality employees. I also want to just take a minute to share some real-life practical examples of one on how this is so important. In my previous life, I worked in a large human resources department for a public utility. And it starts off slowly, but after a couple of years, we noticed in this one department, we had very high turnover. And people may or may not know that turnover is very expensive. So the positions that we couldn't seem to keep for any length of time were very, very technical, very high skilled, but also managerial. And by them leaving after going through the recruitment process, training them, getting them up to speed, and then they leave, it was causing, lack of continuity in the department, and then the people below them would have to step up and fill the gaps. So we're paying lots of overtime and up group rates. And then morale was going down because of all the issues, and we're paying a lot of overtime, and then there's absenteeism because morale goes down, and it turns into this really big mess. So HR stepped in, did the compensation survey, and we realized that we were paying at the 50th percentile for that particular occupation. So we upped it to 75 to 80, and so people got significant raises, and we upped it and hired people. And you know what? In a very short period of time, within 1 or 2 years, turnover went down, morale went up, productivity went up, absenteeism went down, recruitment costs went down, training costs, all of that stuff. So you pay more to not only attract the good candidates, but to retain them, and then you end up saving a significant amount of money. So sometimes you look at a number and you think, holy cow, that's a big number, but really it ends up, we end up with amazing employees, top-notch employees, but we end up saving a lot of money in the long run. So I just wanted to share that practical, real-life example of the markets that we run our organizations in and how we have to address this stuff.
Well said.
Anyone else? Councillor Marsden.
No.
Yes. How can I not speak about it? Financial statement, Brent.
I won't speak about sports.
Exactly. I'll agree with a lot of the comments that have been said. It's a great report. A couple of quick pieces. We do have the consolidated, and then we've got the statement of the general fund. And as you've very clearly explained, that's not all cash. There's all kinds of other pieces of equipment that's in there. So at any point, has there been discussion about having an additional appendix that shows the actual cash in, cash out, so we can see exactly what's there? I mean, quite obviously, the statement of operating expenses. But so it's just the cash. We take away all the.
But part concrete of your financial statements is a consolidated statement of cash flows that just shows the money in and out.
Okay, and that's just
page 4 on your SOFI, and it's probably page 34 would be my guess in here. Just a minute.
Okay.
34. So you have a.
Again, that's your net.
No, 35. That's your statement of cash flows. It shows all the money going
but
in.
That's the changes in your. So it starts with your surplus, your operating, your changes.
Yep.
But in terms of when you look at this, has there ever looked and said, okay, out of the revenue, this is the straight cash period. So, for example, you wouldn't see the developer contribution of $24.7 million. And so that number wouldn't be $283 million. It would be X dollars. So we see exactly what the cash component.
We are legislated to do accrual accounting.
I get that. And I get that. I'm asking as an additional appendix, an addendum from to help with understanding. So you gave a great example with regards to the debt the city has and to relate it to what a resident might look like, a $1 million home with a $10,000 mortgage. Great example. I think from a transparency perspective for a resident, they could relate greater to what's the implication, what cash came in, what cash went out, as opposed to the way it's merged. Now, I don't look at, when I do my cash statement at the end of the year, I don't look at the increased value of my house. I don't add in the things that I, you know, the new water line that I put into my house. I don't put that into.
That's exactly what the statement of cash flows does. It shows the cash going in and out and tells you in big pieces what it is. In terms of restating our statements on a cash basis, our systems are not designed, our systems are designed to do what we need to do, not what another total version. So I guess, could we do that? We could do that. Whether that would have enough value to make, you know, to use Kathleen's lovely expression, to make the juice worth the squeeze.
Well, I get that.
I'm not sure. The number of questions that I get about our financial statements every year is pretty minimal.
Okay.
But I think that our statement of cash flows pretty much covers that.
Okay. All right.
And it's in every statement.
Okay. A couple of these, I spoke about the investment piece and the investment revenue from there. In terms of some of the other comments that have been made around the table, I didn't think the article with regards to that was written. I wasn't going to speak to it with regards to the budgetary expenses of council, because I look at the number and say, in the grand scheme of things, it's a small number, and as long as we're getting value for what we're doing. So I was one of the councillors that was clearly pointed out. It would have been nice to see my statements accurate in the press, but sometimes it doesn't quite translate, I guess, from a telephone call. So that being said, I will echo the comments of my colleagues. It's about ensuring that regardless of what we do, whether it's council attending events, whether it's staff attending events, the key is, did we get value in attending that event? Did we get value in attending that conference? Did we bring something back? So I think as long as we can look ourselves in the mirror and say that we did, I think that's a fair piece. And I extend that same thought process to salaries. I've been critical about salaries and where the numbers are our staff well compensated? There is no doubt our staff are well compensated. Do we need to be? Given the scope of the jobs, I think so. The questions with regards to what's the private sector look like? Well, I believe our organization has 1,100 FTE. The city has 1,100 FTE. Our city manager, according to that, has a remuneration of $300,000. I spoke to a gentleman recently as a company with about 150 FTE, and he said his general manager, not the ultimate person in charge, but his general manager would typically be making $250,000 in that same industry. So with 150 FTE. So not to defend the numbers, but I think if we try to find like comparisons, we can go out there and say that, you know what, senior executives are compensated well. They need to be. They are. And as long as they're providing value, as long as we can look at the end of the year and say we're doing an assessment of our city manager, using him as the example, and say, did we get value for that investment that we put in him? As long as we can come to an agreement with council that we did, I think it's money well spent. So last piece I want to say about the budget, I want to thank you for that. Good report. We'll move on from here.
Thank you, Ms. McLeod. Thank you, Councillor Marsden. I'm going to ask, did we have a move already?
So moved.
Second moved by Councillor Rasmussen, second by Councillor Towner. All in favor? You're free for a year.
Oh, one more.
Oh.
Another one.
One more. And then I'm free.
Item 4 is the 2015 Annual Development Cost Charges Report. The recommendation is that the committee receive the report for information.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Reed, second by Councillor Osmondson. All in favor? Anyone opposed? Carried unanimously. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chief.
Now the important one.
Item 5 is the 2016 Annual Youth Report. We have introductory remarks by the General Manager of Parks, Recreation and Culture Services and a presentation by representatives of the Coquitlam Youth Council. The report is before you for information.
Welcome, Mr. Alueva. Did you tell the youth there will be a test on the financial statements?
Everyone taking notes?
Yes.
You have an accountant in the room.
Some specific terms, superannuation, deferred revenue. In any event, thank you. I'd just like to introduce, first of all, Tara Lind, who's our recreation program coordinator. She's been with the city for 10 years, works out of Pine Tree, and a big part of her portfolio is the youth council. I'd like her to come up and just introduce the youth representatives, and they'll have a presentation for council. Thank you.
Thanks, Earl. So we have two youth council members here today who were nice enough to take time out of their busy exam schedule, one of whom ran here directly from her exam, actually. So Isan Young is a grade 10 student at Pine Tree Secondary, and she just landed her first role as a dance extra in a movie, actually. So she also is going to be teaching children's jazz and dance classes at her studio. And Bogdan Kutsenko, he's a grade 10 student as well at Port Moody Secondary. And Bogdan hosted this year's Reach Awards as part of BC Youth Week. And he sees himself studying to be a Marine officer in the Canadian military. So if you guys want to come up, these two are happy to present to you the youth report.
Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you very much. That's nice.
So you have some audio visual happening? Mm-hmm. Yes?
Prepared.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I'm just going to let you go right to it. Do you want us to ask questions as they come up, or would you rather that we wait until the end? Okay, well, let's do that then.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, hello. I'm Bogdan. This is Isanini. Today, we will be presenting the Coquitlam Youth Council Youth Report, as well as we will be highlighting some of our achievements this year, or some of our highlights this year, as well as introducing some of our focuses for next year. Those are some photos of Coquitlam Youth Council members at our sitting in the mayor's chair at our youth retreat in September.
On a previous report, they overtook the mayor's office.
Yeah, they did some really good work while you were away.
In my chair.
We spent the entire day learning about community as well as city functions. And we brainstormed a plan of action for the upcoming year.
I think they're wearing the chain, too.
Yeah, these are some more photos from the youth retreat.
And as well as our retreat, we also had a lot of fun hosting a barbecue with Rain City Housing. I believe it was in April. Of course, because it was a barbecue, we served a lot of food, played music, just sort of entertainment that way. But our objective was to really interact with the residents that were staying there and sort of just build connections and have a better understanding about what the homeless were really like in Coquitlam. And through this experience, it really touched a lot of the members at CYC, including me. I had a very emotional conversation with one man in particular. I learned a lot about his background, where he came from, how he got to where he was. I found out that he was writing a book. It really just sort of, it was a really enlightening experience because I got to really fully understand how people got into these situations, because you know, you never really think about, you know, how did they get to this? You sort of just see them as is, right? So it's really nice to fully get the whole picture. And yeah, so even though the City Youth Council was not directly involved with the More Sports program, we believe that it really sort of stands for what we sort of advocate for. And we support a lot of the leadership opportunities that it provides high school students in Coquitlam. It began in 2013 and has trained over 200 youth leaders. These youth leaders are now facilitating more sports programs at over 930 elementary schools across 930 students, elementary school students across seven schools in Coquitlam.
The Coquitlam Youth Council is also a proud supporter of BC Youth Week, which is May 1st to the 7th. As you can see by these pictures, the city hosted a variety of different events for youth, such as a cooking event, a bubble soccer tournament, drop-in dance and sports programs, as well as many others. CYC contributed to Youth Week by organizing a youth benefit concert featuring youth artists from the Tri-Cities. We will be using all of the funds raised during the event for future collaborative events at the Rain City Homeless Shelter, which was one of our kind of focus points this year. Oh, yeah. And also, I have my own story to tell about the Coquitlam Youth Council, about our first visit to the homeless shelter. I'm not going to lie. At first, I was a bit skeptical going over there, almost a bit scared. But after talking to some of the people, it kind of opened up my eyes. One man in particular, I talked to him for almost an hour. And he really got me interested in some of the things these people had to share. And this man, he was a military musician who played all over the world in support of Canada's troops. He told me about traveling around Europe to Spain, England, France, Poland. And he even played in Vietnam during the time that Canada was involved there at 1973, I believe it was. And this interaction really got me interested, so I talked to some more people, and eventually I got into a particularly long conversation with this one woman. I talked to her for nearly an hour, and she told me she used to live in England and traveled frequently to France. She told me about all the different places she's been, Italy in particular. I'm actually going to Italy this summer, so she gave me some very useful travel tips. Also, she told me about eating in five-star restaurants in Paris, which was quite a contrast. So, and she also told me about Scotland. We were kind of me and my family were kind of deciding between Scotland and Italy for this summer. And she told me, and she told me about a Scottish food. They have particularly good Angus there.
One more reason. One more reason to go to Italy.
She also told me. Oh, I said Angus, not haggis. She also told me about when she lived in England. She supposedly lived in the same address as the fictitious character Sherlock Holmes, and she was constantly getting visitors wanting to see the place. Now, I don't know what kind of job she had to afford such a lavish lifestyle, but I don't think she could have come up with such a story on the spot. Another thing is I also had the opportunity of hosting the Reach Awards this year. I was the MC, right? Right there. I'm the one in the middle.
Oh,
yeah, see? All right. So, as I said, I was the master of ceremony right there, bottom left corner. I also organized elements of the entertainment. Notice the dance troupe at the bottom right corner. Now, that's the Port Moody Secondary Dance Team. I called them over. I asked them to. kindly asked them to be entertainment for the event, and they kindly obliged. So, another thing I was involved in was obviously the overall planning and execution of the event. I was actually particularly surprised by how well it turned out. The night before the event, I was going through my script because I was the master of ceremony, and I had to read through my script. And for practically every single recipient, it said not attending based on whether or not they responded to the emails. But the day of the event, I was pleasantly surprised by a flood of over 100 people. So I guess this year in Coquitlam Youth Council was certainly one of many surprises. Okay, well, this is Carmen. What do we do for this?
This is Carmen.
All right, I'll read this first section for
you.
You could read it in a higher voice, though, maybe. Perhaps read it in a higher voice.
Can I just read in my regular voice? Thank you very much.
His voice isn't higher anymore.
So I'll read the first bit for the member that didn't show up today. I didn't study it, so I'll just read it how it is. So, the Coquitlam Youth Council supports recreation accessibility for all youth. So, we were happy to hear that nearly half of the 3,827 summer passes last year were sold to youth 12 to 18 years of age. Many of us in Coquitlam Youth Council took advantage of last year's pass to stay active and plan to do so again this year. The pass can be used for drop-in programs, including the fitness centers and pools. Sam.
Yeah. Also by Carmen, but I'm going to be Carmen for the day. So another event that was that involved youth happened at the Coquitlam Library. It held its first ever science expo, where 38 students created and displayed 23 projects at the library. As well as the science expo, it also held several contests to produce artwork for the City Center Library. As you can see on this slide, the photo on the top right is from the children's category, and at the bottom right are some of the winning youth submissions.
You have another section.
What?
Madam.
Oh yes, that's me too. And so just to sort of round it all up, what the CYC what CYC's goal for next year is that we are going to be mainly being an advisory group for the youth in the city, and we would essentially like to become the voice for the youth in Coquitlam. We'll be looking at ways to reach out to our peers, gather all their thoughts and opinions on important city issues, and just sort of applying them. And we're also going to be including their thoughts and opinions into the much anticipated update of the youth strategy. And as well as that, we will continue to support accessible, low-cost youth programs, and our two leadership committees and BC Youth Week. And we're looking forward to collaborating with you on the Coquitlam Youth Strategy.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody have any questions or comments,
yes,
ladies and gentlemen?
Councillor Reid. Well, congratulations to both of you. They're most refreshing to hear from you. Instead of all this staff we've got around who don't have the enthusiasm you've got, it's wonderful. So have you gone to other cities and been in touch with other youth groups, and are they getting stuff from their city that you're not getting, or are they offering programs that you would like to offer?
No, unfortunately, this year we didn't get to do as much kind of collaborating and talking to the different youth groups in the different cities. I think the problem is that this year we kind of tried an extremely ambitious approach. We had three major projects, our homelessness initiative. We actually had a mental health initiative, but that kind of flunked a bit. And then we also had our concert, which we followed through with. So I think the problem with this year is we kind of had too many things planned out, but we weren't exactly able to do all of those things. So I think next year we should probably focus on a few smaller things and kind of be more focused next year. And I'd really like to talk to the different youth groups next year to do exactly what you said,
good,
kind of collaborate with the different cities.
You've had a successful year, and I'm sure next year will be. Just remember, we're all here for you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Councillor Towner.
Thank you very much for coming in today and sharing with us the highlights of your activities. It was great to hear from you. I have a question. Has there been any talk amongst your group? You may be aware that we've had an influx of Syrian refugees to our city, and a lot of them are youth. And I'm doing some work with them, and we have a sort of a youth issues subcommittee looking for outreach and helping the youth get welcome to the city and integrated. And I'm just wondering, has there been any interest amongst your peers in working on any of this with these individuals?
You know what? This is actually a new thing that we heard about. We knew that there are going to be a lot of Syrian refugees coming in, and yeah, quite presumably that a lot of them would be youth. So there wasn't much talk about doing it this year because we had a lot of other initiatives planned out. But I think next year we'll definitely try to work with you in that program because it sounds quite interesting. I think it would be great to sort of have that element as part of CYC.
Okay. Well, let me know if you can contact me, Terry, if you need any more information on that.
I'm very interested in that.
And you may be interested to know that today, June 20th, is actually World Refugee Day, where we acknowledge work that communities have done and raise awareness about the plight of the refugees. Thank you.
Thank you for bringing that up.
Well, congratulations to... Councillor Hodge, go ahead.
No, I just want to say a job well done. I had the opportunity to attend the REACH Awards representing Coquitlam because the mayor was at another function. I just thought you guys did a great job. You did a great job of emceeing. I just want to thank you for being involved in that and for putting that event on together. And, yeah, there's a lot of people there, and it was a good evening, so thank you.
Thank you.
Mayor Stewart.
Yeah, and on behalf of council, I do want to echo those comments. Thank you so much for coming to us. It may be, though, that Bogdan mispronounced your name at the beginning. I sensed that he did, or no?
Yeah, well,
I got a bit nervous.
my name's a pretty difficult name to sort of keep in mind.
Did you want to set the record?
Yeah, it's Isan.
Okay, thank you.
It's okay. There's been a variety of ways that my name can be pronounced. So, I mean, I accept anything that sounds mildly similar. You're okay.
No, I wasn't criticizing him. I just wanted to make sure we had Isan.
Yes.
Okay, Isan. Well, Bogdan and Isan, thank you very much for coming out. And we think of the leadership in our community at the youth level as something that is incredibly uplifting and gives us cause for tremendous optimism for our community, because you're the leaders of tomorrow. And thank you for coming out today.
Thank you very much.
One more. Oops. Councillor Osmundson.
Well, thank you very much. Just a couple of comments is that through your youth committee, we got a bunch of events. We have the 55-plus games here coming up. We're looking for more people to volunteer. Through your youth committee, we'd like to have youth come out and help and volunteer with the 55-plus games. And so if you can put that in your network to the kids within your areas. We also have events at Canada Day. We're looking for volunteers. We have an event here for probably having the chair of the Multiculturalism Committee. We're also looking for youth people with different language skills to help come and translate those out. So something that you could put out through your youth committee to ask for those type of volunteers from the youth to come out. I think it's a way of engaging yourselves with the different age groups and working collaboratively together. So if you can take that back, that would be helpful.
And I think that's another thing that like Coquitlam Youth Council also does well. Because it's kind of been a hub for like acquiring volunteer hours. And I certainly think that should extend to like other people in the community.
Yep. Mm-hmm. We need it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So did you plan to get a bunch of new jobs added to your list when you came to present to us today?
They're just suggestions.
Welcome to council.
Well, thank you so much. Good one, Peter. Yeah. All right. Thank you so much for coming, and we look forward to supporting you in the future.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Good luck in all of this. Report,
guys. Report.
Oh, and does the city own those bubble soccer outfits, or?
No. Not yet. We need those.
Council, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. All right, Madam Clerk.
Madam Chair, the report is yet to be moved or seconded.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Osmundson, seconded by Councillor Marsden. All in favor? Anyone
what
opposed?
Delightful pair.
Yeah. Unanimously carried. Unanimously.
A little bit of energy there, right? Oh my goodness.
I loved it.
I loved it too. Contagious.
Great every year.
All right. Moving on to other business. The first other business item concerns the installation of a rainbow crosswalk and was raised by Councillor Towner.
Oh, okay. So basically, quite a few members of the public have asked me directly by phone, by email, just to bring it up. I know Coquitlam doesn't do proclamations. I know we change our fountain colors sometimes to support different causes, and maybe a rainbow crosswalk would be a proclamation of sorts. But I did tell these people that I would bring it up for discussion, just to see if there's any appetite for considering something like this. Many communities have done it. There's quite a few Lower Mainland communities, lots through Northern BC, across Canada. It's starting to become more common, more accepted. So I just wanted to, I'm not leaning either way, I just wanted to bring it up to see what the appetite was.
Right, Councillor Osmundson.
Well, thank you. I don't think it falls into a proclamation. I could maybe, the mayor can maybe clarify it for me. But I think it's, to me, I don't know if you want to do a crosswalk. I was thinking about this, and I thank you for the suggestion. You know, I think, you know, we have the reaction to happen in Pulse. I think a lot of people are raising some awareness. And I think that's sometimes maybe the wrong. We want to create, and I think, I was thinking that, you know, cities have done crosswalks, but I think a lot of people that walk across those crosswalks don't understand what it means and why it's there. And so I talked to a friend of mine, and we discussed it, and he said, why don't you do something a little different? Why don't you take, like, a park, put a bench in a park that may be a rainbow bench, and put a plaque on it with a, talking about tolerance and what it means for people, that people then either can sit there and contemplate and educate people about it, because his thing was, it's been, why don't you do something different than outside the box that's not being done? And his point is, I would say, he'd say 70% of the people that walk across that crosswalk don't understand why it's there and why you spent all the money to put that in there in different cities. But I think it's something we should really think about as creating tolerance about just not this issue, but other issues that we have out there. This is one group, but I think it's a reaction to Pulse, why we haven't done this. But I think we want to do this in a broader scale, but I think you want to do it for that area. I think it's just a suggestion to council. We don't make a decision today, but I think I think that's just to the issue. I think that might be a better way. To me, I thought about the bench as somewhere where people can come, they can sit, they can read the plaque, they can contemplate the issue. If they don't agree with it, wherever, they can move on past it. It's just a thought.
Councillor Reid.
Well, when I got back and read this, I was kind of surprised, because I've just spent the last week and a half in probably a place where there's so many rainbow things in Palm Springs. There's rainbows everywhere, and trying to bring attention to that specific community. And as you sit there and as you start talking to people down there, they come out with, why should we be celebrating diversity? They're no more diverse than you or I or any of us. It might be a movement, but in some places it draws attention to themselves. And they are, as far as I'm concerned, all of that community is just us. You're just one of us. So why do you have to have something that tries to denote that you're something else? I mean, we don't have a crosswalk for people that are missing limbs. We don't have a crosswalk for people that are blind or deaf, or, you know, some other kind of impairment, or people that speak a different language, or people that have brown hair and blue hair and white hair. Well, why would you want to differentiate? I think we're past that in Canada. I think we're past that. We don't need to be recognizing folks that and saying, well, we're recognizing this because then you're different than us. You're not different than us. We're all the same. We don't have women-only crosswalks and men-only crosswalks. You know, just doesn't make any sense to me. So that's how I feel.
Councillor Wilson.
I love you and I respect you, but I disagree with you.
Well, that's okay. I'll get you later.
You know, it's you know, I don't believe the LGBTQ community is one of us yet, unfortunately. And I think there's still so much discrimination out there that I would fully support doing a crosswalk. I would fully support doing a bench. You know, if we did a crosswalk, you could have a plaque right on the crosswalk button, right? Just like you could have on a bench. But there's huge issues still in that community, and anything that we can do to try to make them feel more welcome, to make them feel like they belong in our community, to break down the barriers that are not, you know, the barriers, but to do something about the discrimination, I would totally support.
I don't see discrimination.
Mayor Stewart.
There is.
Thank you. I've got some comments about it as well, but I noticed Dan Mooney here, as though he's interested in the subject, and given that his responsibility is crosswalks, among other things, I wondered if Mr. Mooney had some input related to
legal implications or any of the design elements? And then I'll get into my own comments.
Welcome, Mr. Mooney.
Thank you. Through the chair to Mayor Stewart. I was asked to look at this issue from a technical perspective, and I can say that we would have no objection from a legal enforcement perspective if we were to incorporate a rainbow crosswalk within the normal bounds of a marked crosswalk. That is, that it would be bounded on the outside by white lines, be complete with all the signs and markings and so on. We also looked at the quality of the materials that they've installed, and we believe that where there are a number of contractors that would have the abilities to do something that would be highly durable and effective, and we wouldn't have any objection, again, from a technical perspective.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Because that solves a bunch of the potentials, and I'm left with similar comments to Councillor Wilson. The LGBTQ community isn't us yet. I think most of us realize that they've come a long way. We've now got a society, I think, where many of the barriers are broken down, but not all of them by any means. And so I'd be supportive of some element. I actually asked staff when I saw this on the agenda, whether it's possible to program the fountain at Lafarge Lake in rainbow colors, and they said no, it's possible to cycle through the colors, but it's not rainbowable, which is a shame, because quite often in fact in the summer sun sometimes you'll see a rainbow through it, and it looks quite spectacular. We were in a conference in Winnipeg, and I remember that moment where the Pride Parade came right through the conference section. The conference center spans over a main street, and the parade came through in the underneath that span, and it was really quite something to have the municipal conference of assembled elected officials from across the country really having the parade come right through us and having us be able to participate a little bit in that. And I remember Councillor Wilson, who grew up in Winnipeg, being incredibly proud of his community, saying they've come a long way. I suspect we've come a long way, but we're not there yet. I don't know whether it's a rainbow crosswalk or a rainbow bench, but I really wanted to be able to embrace the vast diversity, the realities associated with people who face a stigma, face isolation because of their sexual orientation, because of mental illness, because of any number of reasons. And I think our community is ready to embrace that. So but it may well be a bench. It may well be something else. Or, we could issue chalk for Canada Day, and let's make sure we chalk up a big rainbow or something. So.
Councillor Hodge.
Yes, well, thank you. I was just in Cleveland on Metro business shortly after the events in Florida, and it was interesting to see how that community has, or that city has, come together and actually embraced this community. And it's been sort of a rough tough steel town to see how that community has changed. And I was and some of you may have seen it if you were watching the basketball finals, that the pictures of their terminal tower with their old train station tower all lit up in three colors, and I actually had some pictures on my phone. I would have shared them with council, but it was really neat to see it in the rainbow colors. And so when I looked at the idea of the crosswalk, my immediate thought was, again, much as Mayor Stewart had, is what are the technical aspects of this? I'm glad to have that report from Mr. Mooney, because I know that we've had groups come forward and ask for markings on roadways for just, different types of advance warnings and things. And I know there's some work being done on what we can put onto pavement, what's durable. And so my immediate thought was, do we have the right materials, and can we do this? My preference would be to do something in the city. I don't know that the crosswalk is the thing to do. I'm open to the idea. I have a little higher comfort level now that I know from the staff level that we can do it and stay within the regulations for the Motor Vehicle Act, and I know other cities are doing it. If it's a case of every city does one, well, maybe that's why we do one. But I do think there's an opportunity to do something. Let's say I like the idea of a bench or a place where people can just come and sit and overlook the lake, and I think it is important that we do something. I'm just not so sure that the crosswalk is the thing to do unless that is becoming the thing to do. So.
All right. Well, I'll just make a quick comment about in the structure of the strategic plan for the city of Coquitlam. I'm wondering if the idea of a crosswalk is a reaction to an event, and then are we going to support reactions to events over time? Or is it a position of the city to champion inclusion? And I think we have to have a deeper discussion about that. I'm not sure that we can have that discussion at an OB item around the table here. I'm with Councillor Wilson and Mayor Stewart that I'm absolutely open to entertaining the discussion, but I think we need to have an understanding that, as with proclamations, if we do something like this, it opens up the grander scheme of things, which is potentially a pride parade in the future or some other aspects of supporting communities that are persecuted or in the future. So I'm looking at it as a more strategic initiative. I'm, like I said, I'm fully supportive, but I'd like to do it in a more wider way. So that's my comments on it. And Councillor Tunnell, I'll let you close it out.
I just want to say thank you for the discussion. And when I emailed it, in response to getting the requests from members of the public, I didn't really think it would come up this soon. I really appreciate all the input, and I agree with Councillor Zerillo that we need to have a deeper discussion. So I don't know if we put this on the agenda for any future meetings or what's next, but it's not that burning of an issue, but I promise I would bring it up.
So. Yeah, we can add it to the list of the strategic priorities committees. That whole process is designed to allow councillor issues and council issues to have broader discussion, so we'll add that to the list.
Yeah, I think that,
sure.
Councillor Reed? Okay, so I certainly would not vote down you doing any of this, but wouldn't it be nice to have ourselves distinguished as a city that didn't have to have that? Leave it here.
All right. So we have, thank you for
everybody,
Mr. Stedlin. And Madam Clerk.
Right, moving on. The second other business item concerns tree cutting without permits and was raised by Councillor Zerillo.
Thank you. So this is just in regards to a growing number of contacts that I'm having from residents asking me about tree cutting permits. It started at the beginning of the year. In March, I asked for tree cutting permit numbers, and I think we're up to 15 permits at the end of March. And but there's still a number of tree cutting that is happening without permits. We had two incidents last week, and I guess I want to bring it here because I'm wondering if there, what are the current fines? Actually, I should step back a bit. What are the current obligations for homeowners? Because I think this is more about homeowners. What are the current obligations for homeowners in regards to cutting trees? What are the current fines if you operate outside of those requirements? And then maybe I'll have some more questions after that. Thank you, Mr. Alueva.
Thank you. So I will touch base on what we expect from property owners in terms of any investigations around their property for tree cutting, and then I think the acting city solicitor is here just to talk about the process of fines and what occurs. So we do have a tree bylaw, and that tree bylaw does have some a number of regulations within it with respect to what's allowable in terms of a property owner willing looking to cut trees on their property. That bylaw does have certain allowances. The first thing that a property owner would be asked to do is determine in what condition, in what what avenue of tree cutting is their desire, if they're looking to develop their property versus if they're simply managing trees on their property. So we would do that kind of a review with them. Like our first goal would be for them to have get a copy of the tree cutting bylaw, understand the rights. They can call the city. So there's a number of contacts in our city contact. In Parks, Recreation, and Culture, if they're simply managing trees on their property. If they're looking to develop their property, demolish buildings, or redevelop their property through subdivision or redevelopment, they would be asked to contact the Planning and Development Department. Under the Planning and Development Department process, the tree cutting and tree replacement would be dealt with through that those applications. If they're simply looking to manage trees on their property, a simple residential homeowner who has concerns about their trees, the condition of their trees, normally they would be asked to contact their own arborist. Unless the tree is in their mind in a hazardous condition or in a state that they're very concerned about that could potentially have impact beyond their property, they may also contact the city arborist for advice. But first, they would be asked to contact an arborist or a company to manage their trees, and that person or company would be obligated to review our tree bylaw to determine the process by which they could cut. Or consider remedies on those trees. The remedies could be from pruning the tree or trees to cutting the trees if necessary, and those recommendations would have to come from an arborist, and that'd be essentially a recommendation from them. In those instances, council is aware that there are some allowances for property owners. In most cases, if trees are not within a protected area, a covenanted area, a steep sloped area, or a SPIA, or a stream protection enhancement area, two trees per year can be cut under certain circumstances for a standard single-family lot, but it does depend if it's a rural-sized property. In most cases, a standard city lot would have some allowances. But there are many nuances to this, and I appreciate the request for some information. In cases that we've seen in the past, a tree may be straddling a property line or very close to a property line, and unless you know the pins, the actual survey pins. Sometimes fencing may or may not be in existence between two properties. And in other cases, the fence may not be in the right location, so you have to be very careful. In some cases, work around a tree that may be along common property lines may also have an impact, a significant impact, on your neighbor. And that is an issue as well that we typically ask owners to make sure that they contact an arborist so they can see what kind of impact pruning or work around an existing tree that may be on a straddling property line may have on your neighbor. So in a case like a few of the ones we've seen in the past, a company has been brought in, and they may make an assessment that trees may or may not be on that property, and some trees might have been cut without an actual permit being issued or without an authorization from an arborist that it was a hazardous tree that required no permit at that time, or whether it should have had a tree cutting permit. So there's a number of regulations. Now, I do have the acting city solicitor, perhaps that she can come up and just describe what happens once we, from a fine perspective.
I guess the issue for me is over the last 5 months at least, I've had so many calls. And even myself, I was driving down Gaitonsbury last week or the week before, and in peripheral, like a tree, like had to be 40 feet because it was bigger than the house, gone in my peripheral. And I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to pull in and ask them, do you have a permit? But there's so many of them over and over again. I'm getting phone calls and emails that, and I couldn't possibly ask city staff every single week, can you check this one? Can you check one? But I did it last week, and we ended up with two incidents where over four trees have been cut without a permit. Well, we only have 34 trees that have had permits in the 6 months of the year. So how many are actually?
Well, I think that was 34 tree cutting permits. Yeah. The number of trees within those permits, I didn't. That information was not requested, but it was 34. Permits. And there's a half a dozen that are currently in process right now.
So I guess what I'm asking is, I'm feeling like we're a little, maybe our fines aren't being a deterrent, or there's an education gap out there. And we know on one of them that happened, the business the person had a business license in the city. They know the rules, like what are our what are our, I can't think of the word right now, but how can we respond to that in a way that's punitive, that makes it not happen again? I guess that's my concern.
Through the chair, yes, we're aware of the issue. It is a challenge. The tickets under the bylaw are all set at $500, which is the maximum for the Bend ticketing system. And staff in urban forestry enforce that, make the decision when to issue tickets. And they're the appropriate people to receive questions and complaints that members of the public may have. If they come through to our group, we often act as extra eyes in the field because Mr. Alueva's staff are more limited than ours. But ultimately, it's their group that determines whether a permit was necessary, whether it was a protected tree, and then writes the tickets for it.
So as a counselor, when I'm around or if I see it or someone phones me, I mean, I don't want to overburden. We already saw in a report last week or the week before that we're getting an abundance of calls about questions about trees being dangerous with what's happened just with our weather lately. Like, what can I do as a counselor? How much access do I have to come to staff and say, can you check this one? Can you check this one? Can I pull over when I see a tree coming down where it looks like it's been flattened, felled dangerously? Can I pull over and ask, like, what is a counselor's?
Yes. Any member of the public, any member of council can contact our group at any time if you have a concern. That's certainly anyone's prerogative. And at that point, we'd as quickly as possible determine whether there's a tree cutting application that's been submitted and a tree cutting permit issued on that property. And if that isn't the case, then we would send a staff member out and take a look and see whether an activity is happening on site that is in contravention of the tree cutting bylaw regulations. So we would do that routinely. Again, the number of eyes and ears we have at one time, look at a number of these cases, varies. There are cases where you may have a development application that is initiated on a site that might be the generating kind of approval process for that particular tree cutting permit instance. But that, again, it varies depending on the site. Clearly, if it's just a regular single family home and you could see trees being cut, and any member of the public can put an inquiry through the city to determine whether that's lawful tree cutting that's happening on that site.
So I'm always, I mean, obviously this is something that I'm interested in. What is the birth of the tree cutting bylaw? Why do we have a tree cutting bylaw? Like, why do we care if trees get cut? Like, what are we trying to, I guess I'm wondering, what is the history of the tree bylaw? Why do we have it in the first place? Why can't people just cut whatever they want if it's their private property?
I wasn't here when it would at its birth. Jim McIntyre here was here, however. But I have certainly seen the birth of a number of tree cutting bylaws in different municipalities, and clearly it's an important bylaw that tries to reconcile the preservation and replanting and reforesting. So the number of objectives of our tree canopy in the city with development and the growth and evolution of the city. And there's a whole range of underlying philosophy and regulations, and that spans a spectrum from significant deforestation to replanting of areas. And in other cases, you know, largely it's about balance, but I wasn't around, but I certainly have stated in the past and certainly in open council that there is an underlying philosophy behind the current bylaw, and it did go through council approval process and a significant debate at the time, and it is a relatively balanced piece of work, but it is up to council to decide whether it continues to do what council seeks it to do.
Okay. And Mr. McIntyre, did you want to speak?
Thank you, Raul. Yes, thank you, through the chair. Believe it or not, there was a tree bylaw when I arrived here in Coquitlam about 11 years ago. But actually, tree bylaws, municipal tree bylaws, probably date back to the late 70s, early 80s, at least in my previous places of employment. When they first came out, actually it was interesting, I was working in the interior, and there was concern about possible implications and impacts on forestry action. And there was quite a discussion and debate at the time. It was the Municipal Act, and it was very narrowly focused for municipalities, for areas within municipalities. It wasn't supposed to affect forestry operations. It was essentially targeted to where you'd have steep slopes that if you remove the vegetation from that slope, slope, it may destabilize that slope, cause landslides and that. That then expanded into, I guess, the growing interest or understanding around riparian corridors. So those two were areas that were subject to tree removal controls. And I know when I came to Coquitlam, they had a bylaw, it was called the tree protection bylaw. It was essentially focused on that. And
safety reasons.
Safety of slopes, riparian areas, and I think designated areas too, where some of the planning had been done that identified areas of risk or a desire for preservation. That bylaw has since evolved over time, at least two revisions or additions since then, and essentially it's in the form that Mr. Alloway have just described a few moments ago. There is an interesting sort of interplay between the urban forestry group in Parks, Rec, and Culture, Raoul's department, as well as environmental services and engineering public works, and then on the development side and planning. So we do try to provide a coordinated communication between the staff when we're dealing with development applications to have other areas of the organization aware and providing feedback or commentary. And if there's issues that come up, like, for example, in connection with a development application, be for a building permit, for a subdivision, if there was or is unauthorized tree removal, other areas of the organization come in and get involved, and we deal with that in a coordinated fashion. Just the last thing, if I could, we ourselves are sometimes at the staff level challenges to making sure, you know, who's who and who does what. So we are in the process of preparing some information that's ultimately intended to be public to provide greater information and clarity about if you have this situation, you have this issue, here's who you call in that. So we are working on that, and we'll get that to council when it's done.
I appreciate it, because it is a growing dialogue that's happening in our community. Mayor Stewart, and then Councillor Reid.
So going back a number of years, we did, as has been explained, we had almost no protection for trees on private property other than slopes. And we're contemplating how do we establish some protection without at the same time establishing effectively a penalty for planting trees. In my own property, for example, when we built our home, we planted 30-something trees. I think 27 of them are still thriving. We lost one to a Dutch elm disease, etc. But if I were to try to remove a tree today from my property, it's a tree that I planted. And so one, at the same time as we want to figure out how to protect the urban forest, we also don't want to put in place unintended barriers to people planting trees. There was 6 years ago, or 7 years ago, council went to a program of planting 10,000 trees in primarily on city and private property, and so we were actually giving out trees at festivals and such. And people, one of the questions we had was, so when it gets big enough, we have to cut it down so that we don't get penalized. My neighbor did that when we were talking about the tree protection bylaw. He's a strong environmentalist. He brought in Paul Bunyan during the debate over the tree bylaw because he didn't want us to pass a bylaw saying he couldn't manage the trees on his own property. He ended up removing most of them, which was a shame because we actually came up with rules that said, no, we're gonna let you have the flexibility to remove, to manage your own trees, because I think it's counterproductive to, you know, there are streets in Vancouver, for example, where it's a row of Vancouver specials built in the 70s, and there are still no trees because on the private property because no one will plant trees. They know in Vancouver that if you plant a tree, it's not yours anymore, and you don't have the flexibility to do whatever you want with your property in the future. So we end up with people learning the lesson of not planting trees. So that's some of the background behind the current rules. I, though, am one of the ones that probably phones bylaws more often than anybody about all kinds of elements, but certainly trees being cut down when I think, it's typically on weekends, and it's a typically a tree company that you don't recognize. If you do ever approach one, like Paul Bunyan or whatever, they're some of the ones that do a lot of work in our community, I guarantee they'll have a tree permitter because they're not going to risk their ability to work in Coquitlam alongside our arborists and such, or urban forestry folks, for one contract to take out a tree that doesn't have a, take out trees that for which a permit would be required, but for which a permit wasn't sought. The development, we often see a tree company, if I see a tree company that isn't from here, that I've never heard of before, sometimes I'll count the number of trees they're actually targeting, because if it's more than two, then I may ask if I'll send a note to staff saying, is this particular address subject to a tree permit? And in most cases it is. And where it isn't, you know, we can't have eyes on every street. And we, last comment, the penalties were restricted as to what we can do for penalties for flagrant flaunting of this. It doesn't happen too often, but when it does happen, I think we have to make sure the development industry knows that we're going to throw the book at them to the extent we can. We're going to make it incredibly, but that they should not, they must not deliberately disregard the expectations that this community has about the urban forest. And if they do, if a penalty was if a permit was required and they didn't take out a permit, then life will not be easy for them in the coming months. So,
thank you for those comments, Mayor Stewart. And Councillor Reid.
This has been a problem since 25 years. It became a bigger problem when we started Burt Mountain, because then we had to clear cut, and that became a huge problem. But you couldn't leave bunches of trees up because the roots would have been damaged and it would have just been terrible. And so that brought the whole tree bylaw to the fore again. And it's always hard because you have private property rights. People own their land and they buy it and it has six trees on it and they want to get rid of a couple. And of course, then they used to just chop them down and willy-nilly. And then we put the permit in where you had to come in and get permits. And some of the people don't want to bother getting permits. And those are the folks. I mean, I don't think over the last 20 years people understand now that if you want to cut down a tree, you need a permit. And if you don't get a permit, you should have a giant fine. And I'm talking in the thousands of dollars. The problem is, when you're allowed to cut down so many, one or two a year, then people, if they have 6 years, in 3 years, those trees will be gone because they don't want to have to be raking up leaves or doing something with it. And funnily enough, over the years, as you track this, the people that are complaining about people cutting trees down, the people who are cutting them down are send you a letter about how happy they are to be able to walk in our forests. They don't want to have a tree on their land, but they're sure happy to walk in our forests. So it's really a thankless job trying to do this, because and you and I have had this conversation. I don't know what we can do other than have large fines. And I don't think we can ever, with private property rights, say you do not have the ability not to ever cut down a tree on your property unless it's dangerous or something. So I think I have to be with Mayor Stewart on this and just say, if a tree is cut down without a permit and proper permission, maybe we could look at strengthening permission more if it's needed to be cut down for a specific purpose, you know, a danger or damaged or something like that. But not allowed, you know, just not encourage people to cut down trees just willy-nilly. And if they do, that there are huge fines attached to it.
Thank you, Councillor Reid. Councillor Asmundson.
Well, thank you. You know, agreeing with Mayor Stewart, I've been around since and was here for the debate on the tree bylaw. We found a balance, I really believe, into what was going on. The bylaw started because of development of housing on Austin Avenue above Gilby, and some people was clear cut to put in three new homes. And people complained, as Councillor
Donnelly that asked for a review of it, and we hired a consultant. We did a review. The review of the consultant's report at that time was that there was no real tree loss by residential people. The future tree loss is going to be because of the development, larger footprints on development, because we're densifying areas. And what we did at that time is we also then realized that fact. We put in planting requirements within new developments, but we also went to educate. When you look at a lot of the problems in Coquitlam today, and remember, you know, Coquitlam was logged complete and then was also relogged a second time in all the areas throughout most Coquitlam. And there's a lot of trees that people have planted on property lines, right up against houses, trees that are hazardous, different issues, that when we did the bylaw, we created a plan for in the planning department, development services, when people in New South Wales are planting their trees, they're not to plant them on property lines or near property lines, planting them away, so they're away from houses. We created rules on where you should be planting trees because the trees that affect other people's driveways, sidewalks, other people's properties, we created for new developments on what that are people. And when you look at today, back to Mayor Stewart's comment, people do take down trees in their area, maybe because of the backyard. I think Councillor Towner mentioned earlier about clearing up a bunch of trees so they could have a backyard that their young children could use, and they needed to open up that backyard. But if you look at the nurseries around the region here, they sell a tremendous amount of trees, and people are planting trees in their area. They may be taking down a tree they feel is hazardous or in the wrong area, but people are replanting a lot of trees every year within this area. And if you look at greenhouse gas emissions, young trees take in more greenhouses than trees once they hit around 70 to 80 years old, stop really taking in this amount of carbon dioxide into them. It's the younger trees that do that. This is an issue and about a balance. And I think in this bylaw, we strive for balance and between the rights of what people can do on their property by allowing to take down up to two trees a year. You find very few areas where you see people taking two trees down, unless they have this huge lot that's only forested by trees. But I do encourage anyone on council, and I've done it for a long time, I know Mayor Stewart said he's done, I have seen areas where I did not think that it was done right, where there's some improper clearing of trees or whatever, and I've reported it through to staff. I've asked them to go out there and inspect or check or do anything. And that's fine. I think we should all do that. I think a lot of people that look at somebody taking down a tree on their own private property, maybe you don't live in a house, don't live in that area, but they don't have to maintain that tree. They don't have to do all the other issues that come with that tree. And it was a thoughtful, long, drawn-out affair to create the bylaw that we have. But I think in the end of the day, we felt, I think May would agree, we think we hit a balanced spot.
We thought we had.
And I think we still have a balanced spot here. And the canopy in Coquitlam, as people talk about preserving the canopy has changed for 125 years, or actually before we were incorporated, the canopy of Coquitlam's changed. And that report stated that the canopy is going to continue to change due to density. And we do trade-offs, and that report did trade-offs. We have agricultural land, we have sensitive areas, we also have an urban containment of this area where we don't do sprawl. So when we don't do sprawl, we're saying that we are going then to put more density into this area to protect and not sprawl out into these other areas. So there's these trade-offs that you have within this and that bylaw, and I think that bylaw recognized those issues. And so I think when I talked to engineering, I talked to Raul about, and I think what they're working on now, a couple of weeks ago, I was informed about with potentially a problem of illegal tree cutting, and about the response that we need to be better at from a city to respond quicker to a complaint and get out there and inspect faster. I think that's something we can do, that when a complaint comes in, that we can get our staff out there quickly to assess it right away and get back to people right away. There's been a problem, I think. Staff has realized that. They've worked on that, and I think we're going to be getting a better response out to our public. And I think that's one of the keys that came from that one there that I talked to two, 3 weeks ago. I raised that with them, and they've been working on that ever since. But that's part of our role as a counselor. You see something wrong, just like general public, you're no different. Speak up and let people know. Thank you.
Thank you for those comments. I think that's why I wanted to bring you today, not to get into the discussion about the tree bylaw. I was interested in the birth of it, but the fact that there's dialogue, that this is happening in the community, and that I did want to escalate it so staff is aware that there's a lot of it happening, perceived
proceed.
Councillor Marsden, and then Mayor Stewart.
Thank you. Just very quickly, as I've said before, I've worked with a resident recently in regards to this. I think the counter staff were great in identifying what trees she was allowed to take down, what the requirements were for replanting, and where the bylaw was. So I think where around the table, it's very clear the intent was to try and find a balance between private property rights and maintaining a treescape. So the picture that the mayor has put up has no trees. I don't think that's really attractive. So I think it's important that we have that balance. I think this does it. I think the key that we've got is on the ones that are being done without permit. So people that are blatantly disregarding, that's where the real concern is. So there's blatant disregard for the rules. And so I believe what I've heard from Ms. James is that the maximum amount of the fine is 500. That's what our bylaw is set at, correct?
That's correct.
5,000.
Okay. And I appreciate
per tree. Mm-hmm.
Per tree? Correct?
Yes.
It is per tree. Okay, so that's the maximum amount of the fine. So our bylaw stipulates that, again, if you get a permit, you can do certain things and you have to replant depending on a number of parameters. Is there, from a legal perspective, is there anything we can do in addition to this fine for those that break the rule? Or can we require that they replace? And then there'd be a covenant. Is there other pieces that we can do as opposed to somebody just looking saying, it's a business decision, I'm spending the $500 a tree because my value went up by $100,000 because of the view? Is there other pieces we can do?
Through the chair, that's certainly an issue that I've seen a lot of municipalities grapple with, particularly when the cutting is on municipal property. Classic case of people improving their views by cutting down parks.
Yeah.
In a true bylaw enforcement sense, your options are ticket or prosecute. So we ticket. Perhaps there's an appetite for pursuing other forms of bylaw enforcement, such as MTI prosecutions or Offense Act prosecutions in the most egregious cases. Those, of course, come with the time and expense of the court system, but there is more restorative justice type remedies available through that process. It is theoretically possible in either a prosecution or a civil injunction to get damages that the person has to replant. The tricky issue with tree cutting is often respective knowledge of the property owner versus the company conducting the cutting, and figuring out who of those two is more legally liable or morally culpable. It can be challenging, and it comes down to he said, she said, and often not enough evidence to proceed with a prosecution either way.
Yeah. Okay. And to go the additional extent about replacement, it would have to go the MTI route, is what you're saying.
Yes, I think so.
It's not something we could make a bylaw amendment that would enable to give us that piece.
No, I don't think that would fit within the context of general bylaw enforcement. You commit an infraction, you get ticketed. It's generally how it works.
All right. Because again, I think you hit the nail on the head with a couple of pieces. With, is it the homeowner? Is it the person doing the work? And the homeowner I worked with very clearly, going through the process, we had to confirm, A, the person going to do the work had a business license to operate in Coquitlam. They didn't. They got one. So we got a new business license for the city. And then, of course, the permit themselves. But that individual, when they showed up on site, they were adamant that that permit had to be there. And if the homeowner went out, that permit had to be there so they could show it to bylaw if they showed up. An angry neighbor that might not like the decision this person was making. So my key, and I agree with Councillor Reed's general comment, that we want to make sure that we're taking it as far as we possibly can in terms of penalizing somebody that's blatantly disregarding the rules. And that's where the issue is. Not those that are operating within the rules that have past councils have adopted. So, okay. We'll have to think more about it. Thank you.
Mayor Stewart.
Thank you. I just wanted to explain the context of the photo. This is just a pretty typical East Vancouver streetscape. There's lots of them like this. These are a row of homes built before I was born that have never had trees, likely, because it was in the 80s that council adopted really strict protection of trees in Vancouver, and perhaps as a result, or at least in that context, the entire street's going to have no trees. In Coquitlam, this would be really a rarity, but in Vancouver, it's not a rarity. And I think that's the balance we always have to play with the type of regulation we choose to protect the urban forest. At the same time, once we choose a regulation, we should enforce it very strictly to the extent that we can, recognizing we have limits, but there's other things we can do, particularly in the case of trees removed for development within the development process.
Thank you. And so, yeah, it's about the enforcement of those bylaws, and I always appreciate, Ms. James, your comments. Appreciate it. Okay. I will be phoning in. If I'm allowed, I'm doing it.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, that is the last formal item on the agenda.
All right. So move adjournment, someone?
Motion adjourned.
So move seconded. Okay.
Do they have
favor? We are adjourned. Anyone opposed to adjourning?
Nope.